Dear viewers, it's not sufficient how many ever shows we have on beauty and fashion, because everybody wants to meet the specialist who can provide all the solutions to the beauty problems. Hi, with me today, Daisy Morgan, who is from Singapore, but has started her spas in Bangalore and Hyderabad. She's a specialist in beauty and also wedding-related business. Warm welcome to the show.
Hello, hi.
So what exactly do you do in your business? You're into beauty, spa and fashion.
That's right.
And what is this wedding-related business to?
You see, we actually bring in wedding gowns, actually design wedding gowns. We do rental of wedding gowns, evening gowns, and even Indian fusion, very Indian fusion kind of costumes for our couples that also matches with the groom.
Okay.
After choosing their suits, they actually go in for a photo shoot also, where they actually change different costumes.
And see as to what suits them the best.
Yes, that's right.
Okay, or is it just for the photo shoot?
No, it's not only for the photo shoot. They also use it on their wedding day. And okay. On their wedding day, we actually have a big portrait for them. A very okay. Singapore touch. It's usually a common thing in Singapore before you get married. Couples go in for a photo shoot.
Okay.
Where they actually
just to see whether they're the perfect pair.
No, not really. But they actually keep pictures of themselves, different kind of pictures, like a picture in...
This is what we look like before marriage. This is how we look after marriage.
I have some couples who actually take pictures of their school uniform, how they were looking when they were in school.
Okay.
And then as they were growing up, how, and then the places where they met.
Okay.
And then they keep it all in an album.
Memorabilia.
Yes, and they keep it in an album and they actually display it during the reception of
okay.
their wedding.
So you make them look the best before the wedding, during the wedding, after the wedding and all.
That's right. And even after, when the kid is born.
Oh, okay.
Even till then.
So it's basically about dressing them up, is it?
Dressing them up, everything. It comes in a whole package. Before
okay.
you dress them up, you got to do the necessities, like, you know, they have to go in for their beauty treatment.
Okay, but you're also specialized in wedding gowns.
That's right.
Okay, but you design them yourself, or do you have other people who assist you?
I do design some of it by myself, and I do have other designers who actually help me out in it, because I can't do it all by myself alone.
Okay,
yeah.
But you're also in the business of beauty to such an extent that you're quite worried as to, you know, even a small pimple on the face also
That's
can
right.
worry you so much.
Exactly.
So?
Yeah, I mean, being in the beauty line, if I don't look good, how will people trust me then?
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, that's why even the little pimple that I was just telling you, oh, there's a pimple on my face, how now?
Okay.
So even that worries me. So I always have to keep up to date.
Okay.
And
but you could be in trouble in a country like Singapore, because, you know, you need to be absolutely perfect before you offer a service. Correct? Right. You need to know your field extremely well. So if you really, you know, need to advise somebody about how they could take care of their skin, to their looks, you need to be a model yourself.
Actually, I used to model
okay.
Many
you
years ago.
You participated in this Singapore International Beauty Contest.
I actually participated in 1999 Miss Singapore Indian Worldwide. I came in top 10.
Okay.
But the thing was, after that, I organized
okay.
Miss Singapore and Mrs. Singapore Indian Universal. Miss, Mrs. and Little.
Oh, okay.
In 2007, I organized this. We actually made the Mrs. contestant who, you know, after giving birth, they were so big. We made them go on a crash diet
oh, okay.
and they lost about 10 kilos. So there was a
Everybody
whole
wants to look good, right?
Definitely.
And these are like chess, participating in the contest.
Yeah, exactly.
So, and if you've actually gone through the regimen, if you really know you've done it well, that you could go to a contest like this and find out as to whether you've really done what you're expected to. Everybody wants to look good in the mirror.
Definitely.
And people like you help them to look good.
Exactly.
Everybody wants to, but it's a very difficult thing to achieve it.
In the beginning, when I was young, I used to have a lot of acne problem, and I used to feel so shy to even go out. So it came a point of time how I came into this business was like, I was finding for solutions. Okay, how can I become slim? How can I look beautiful? So I started to read a lot about the whole, you know, and I used to look at fashion TV. I used to look at all the models walking down the ramp and how do they apply, you know, makeup and stuff. And I used to practice on my own. I kept practicing and practicing and practicing, and that's when it led me into the beauty line.
Okay, there is some beauty in everybody, some intrinsic beauty, right? So each one looks unique in his or her own way. So is it actually possible for you to say that I'll make you look beautiful?
Okay, example, if a lady comes to me and she says, Daisy, I want to look beautiful, okay?
What do you define as beautiful?
See, someone who keeps, it's not about, you give me a dress to wear, how ugly it is, it's about how you carry it. You make the dress look beautiful.
Okay, by carrying it the right way.
Carrying it the right way, that's right.
But also wearing something that suits you. Something that may not look very nice on somebody else can actually look nice on you.
Because the
by making the right choice.
Not only the right choices, but how the person carry, whether the person can carry such a... Example, if you give a sari, I went for a fashion show and I saw this white girl wearing a sari. And she had so much of difficulties walking in it.
Okay.
She was actually, you know, walking with her leg.
It was a clumsy thing around her.
Precisely.
Okay, like she was wrapped in that sari rather than actually she wearing it.
Yes, she didn't, you know, she was not confident in it.
Okay.
So she was not able to carry herself well, but if you're confident in what you're wearing...
Okay. Do you advise people as to what they need to wear, to what suits them, to how they can be comfortable in their clothes, to also do you put them through some sort of a counseling so that they can understand their clothes and dressing and looks better?
I don't put them through any counseling, but when I meet a customer, I usually get her to pick her own clothes first.
Okay.
Once she picks up her clothes and she tries it on, I will be able to make out her whole body proportion and what kind of person she is. Okay. According to that, I will actually recommend her what she can wear or what she shouldn't wear.
So you would improvise on the clothes she would have chosen, so you can actually work on the clothes that she likes, right?
Yeah, I would improvise. I might add on something, some extra material. Like in India, they're pretty conservative. Okay. Brides, they wouldn't want to wear something which is a bustier or a sleeveless. So what I do is I will attach lace on their sleeve to give them sleeves.
Okay.
Or I even have a fur coat. So I improvise depending on the theme of the wedding. Some of them do have themes.
Okay. But do you actually give them some sketches in the beginning or do you actually show them some photographs of, you know, some possibilities of
I
how
usually have
can
ready
be...
samples in my shop.
Okay.
So either I show them that or I will sketch and I just show them, is this how you want it? And what I'll do is I will get it manufactured and I will design,
okay,
manufacture and
but
give to them.
Women are conservative even otherwise, whether they are fashionable or not, because they tend to get stuck in their styles. So it's very difficult to do this change management, right? To be able to get them to get adapted to a new thing that you'd be suggesting to them.
You see, initially when someone is wearing something, they might find it too open. But after wearing it, it looks different, you know. What you see and what you wear on will look definitely different. It won't look the same. Because it depends on our body shape also, isn't it?
And most people actually wait for comments and also appreciation, right? Because, you know, till they actually get it, they are not very comfortable. Till people start telling them, oh, it's okay, you look nice and all that. Otherwise, even by wearing clothes, you may actually feel like you're not wearing anything at all because, you know, you feel so naked in front of people because you're constantly conscious of people's eyes on you, right?
Yeah, that's true. But you'll be surprised. We actually started our online sales right now, where we actually sell our modern wear and even our Indian wear online.
Okay.
And we're getting a huge response in India, in Emirates, and even in Europe.
Okay.
So people are buying online without even trying it on. They're only looking at pictures of models wearing those clothes. They buy it online and we send it to Korea.
But each person has his own fit. Is our own fit. So how is it possible for you to sell something that may or may not fit the person after they buy it?
Currently what I'm doing is, since I have lots of customers buying online, most of the measurements I actually give it online, so they do have to measure. Some customers who really feel that they're a bit on a bigger size and they're worried. Okay. What happens is they send me a picture of themselves. And I will actually tell them, I think it's better not. Or I think, okay, yeah, you can go ahead. You've got a good body. Go ahead. This will look, really okay. look good on you. So based on email, they
sort of online counseling.
I think people nowadays are trusting another. Okay.
And they're quite bold also. They're quite open about it. It's not like, you know, you're fat and you want to hide the fact that you're fat, though the whole world is seeing you as a fat person.
I think they've become more open. The
honest with themselves rather.
Yeah, they have passed. I think that stage has already passed, and they have come forward and say, hey, this is how I am.
Is it actually true that women try to fit into a dress by losing some weight and all that, or is it just what you see in the advertisements?
It's absolutely true.
Oh, they actually come and tell you, look, I want to lose weight, I want to look better, so I want to
I
wear the dress.
I wouldn't even say another woman, even me myself.
Okay.
I sometimes even want to go on a crash diet of like 5 kilos or 3 kilos and really go on a, I exercise regularly, you know, every day and go on a strict diet where you can't even have rice. And someone who succeeds in that strict diet.
And you become so confident after that.
Exactly. You feel so confident, you can wear anything, you can dare to buy anything you want.
Okay. And you can teach other people also.
Exactly.
You're like your actual model then telling other people, look at me, and you can emulate.
But it's not easy to lose weight.
Okay.
It's not easy.
But how did you actually get into this beauty business? Just because of your own urge to become beautiful?
You see, I had a lot of flaws.
But you also did your course with Shehnaz Hussain's.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You see, I had a lot of flaws in me. Like, I felt, oh, my skin was no good. And my body was, you know, my hip was too big. And I was trying so many things in my life, you know, to rectify these problems. But every time I try to rectify it, I realized that I was getting worse and worse and not getting better. So what happened was, I was not a study smart person. I'm more of a street smart person.
Okay.
You put me on the street, I would just survive there. You give me, you put me in school, I would just, I feel as if I'm dying there, you know, that kind of person. So it came a point in time like, where am I leading? I don't know what am I doing, you know? And usually what happens is during weddings, like my sister got married, I would start doing makeup for her, start doing her hair.
Experimenting.
Yeah, I'll do it for everybody. So Mama was like telling me, my auntie was telling me, since, you know, you're good with your hands, why don't you start go to India, go to Bangalore, go to any part of India and learn a course, you know, learn a beautician course. So I came to India, I didn't have anybody here, and that's when I met my teacher. She's a franchisee of Shehnaz in Bangalore.
Okay.
And over there, I learned my course, threading, facial. And I was a pampered child because...
And you started... Started it on yourself first.
Oh no, I actually...
It's not actually easy to thread yourself, but still.
No, what I used to do is I actually went to the orphanage home every day.
Okay.
And I used to practice on the kids.
Oh my God, that's really
bad. I used to cut their hair. Okay. I used to draw henna on them.
Oh, and but they enjoyed it too because they were getting all the attention.
Yeah. And I started to realize
that... Very smart thing to do.
I used to do that every day. And because I didn't have anyone in India.
Okay.
So I felt that it was so fun doing it for the kids. And they loved... Whenever... You see, kids, they are so innocent. Mm. You do something for them, they're like, ah, this is so nice. You know, they can think. So you feel more confident.
Least critical about...
Yes. When someone demotes you, then...
But then, why did you decide to start a spa in Bangalore?
After my course, I went back to Singapore. And it took me many years to try and penetrate into India. I was trying very hard. India is a very good market for business. And I tried, I couldn't, I tried, I couldn't. Finally, after opening up my setup in Singapore, after 3 years, I actually, I told you I was nominated for the Singapore Entrepreneur Award. And I actually planned out what is my steps towards my goal in life. So I actually told in my interview just last a year ago that my next step is to open up a spa in India.
Okay, and you did.
And thank God I did it.
Okay, now we have one in Bangalore, one in Hyderabad.
Hyderabad I just opened last month.
Okay.
And that was another goal I told myself that I have to open up. I got to open up.
And you've been getting these Thai girls and all
yes,
to do
my
authentic
girls are,
massage.
Yes, my girls are from Thailand, Malaysia and Singapore.
Okay, not from India.
We have a few girls from India, of course.
Okay.
Definitely, we want our Indians to also be part of the team. The reason why is why I had a cosmopolitan workers in my own spa itself, because I want people to come in and feel as if they're
actually getting it done in Thailand.
Yes, or Singapore or something else, not, you know, in India.
Okay.
So they feel,
what's the fun in doing something that's very Indian in India? Experience something else.
Sorry?
Experience something else.
Yes, exactly. Okay. And many customers do feel that they are not in India.
How does it work in terms of costs?
In cost, oh. Yeah,
because, you know, I mean, you need to really, you know, get your customers to pay more.
Yeah. Then again, I feel that India has a very, it's got a very potential market. Mm. It depends on how well you serve. You got your more customers coming in. My pricing is very reasonable.
Okay.
So I do have a huge quantity of people coming into my spa. And,
but you have something very oriental also, or is it very conventional? Like you have something that's Chinese or something. Something that's very Thai in nature.
Certain locations in my spa, which is about 3,500 square feet, we have certain areas which give you a different kind of atmosphere. Like one part you feel very woke. Mm. There's a part where, you know, where the hair styling place, you feel very woke, you feel very stylish. And where there are rooms for, you feel as if you're in Thailand.
Okay.
And certain rooms, you feel as if you're in Singapore. So
there are smells of Thailand,
yes,
to the,
yeah, of
incense,
course,
to aroma, yes, to...
Yes. Correct? I'm very particular about cleanliness. So those who come into my spa, they have to remove their shoes before entering.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I'm very particular.
How is your business doing in Singapore?
It's good. It's good.
Okay, was it difficult to start it there? But you knew everything about Singapore because you were born there.
I always believe every step to success, you have to face your tough rights. You have to face your problems before you.
And you're
success.
A street smart person. You're called for yourself.
No matter how, you know, smart you are, you know, working on the street, you still face problems. And the problems you face will reach you to success.
Okay.
That's what I always believe. So, till today, I do face lots of hurdles, but I take it as a learning point. Whatever hurdles I face, to me, I'm learning from it.
Okay, but you're someone who actually believes that Indian women have a lot of potential, but they're quite laid back.
Yes.
They need to really become, you know, street,
yeah,
smart and also beautiful. They
actually
have that intrinsic beauty, but they need to explore it.
I met, you know, Indian women are so beautiful. I met so many of my customers, especially girls who are getting married, who are really young, 22, 23. And so I asked them, you know, so what's after marriage? Say, no, I got to stay at home. I had a customer I met yesterday. She said, I got to stay at home every day. I said, every day you stay at home? Yeah, I got to be a housewife. I said, but you're 22. She said, yeah, and the worst part, you know, I got to wear sari every day in the house because that's the culture. Mm. I was like, oh, okay. I said, will you be able to keep up to it? She said, well, you know, it's already arranged. It's already, I'm already getting married. So I'll just go with the flow and be a good housewife. When I even asked her, so did you study and finish up your degree? And she's like, yeah. I said, oh, God should have given me your brains. At least I could have studied and climbed up further than what I'm, you know, I am right now. Because not everybody can study and pass really well.
But do you
well.
Also talk about this inner beauty and all that, which everybody speaks, at least for convention's sake?
You see, everyone has inner beauty.
Okay.
Everyone. Not
but
only a
so
woman who stays
because,
in the
because,
house.
Because, you know, do you actually believe that the inner beauty exudes on the face? That, you know, I mean, if you're a good person, you actually look good. Is it actually a possibility?
Not really. I don't really think so.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because so actually the makeup is what actually that shows what kind of a person you are.
Exactly. Being on a TV show, you should know better than me. Makeup does the wonders. It makes someone who very ordinary look extraordinary.
But people are very beauty conscious these days. Even men.
70% of my customers are men. And they come very regularly to my shop. Regularly, in a sense, they come and do their pedicure, manicure, facial, detanning.
Most often for hair problems.
You
don't deal with it?
No, we do.
Oh, okay.
We do deal with hair problems also. We also do. Comparing Singapore and India, I'm pretty surprised. I was pretty surprised when I started in India that men are more worried about their looks than the women in India.
Than in Singapore?
Than in Singapore.
Okay.
In Singapore, I don't have that many men customers. I've got 20%. In India, I've got 70%.
What do they come asking for?
They say, Daisy, you know, I went to Goa. I'm so dark now. Can you do a detan? I'm like, yeah, okay. Detan. And then I have a customer, a man customer, who comes in every 3 weeks to get his pedicure done.
Okay.
Which I don't really see any men in Singapore doing it. very rare, okay? And I think
threading.
Yes, we have lots of, in Singapore, we have got almost lots of men coming in for threading.
Okay.
Threading is like a very common thing in Singapore.
It's also, particularly in India, you may have seen with this man that men are more, hairy than Chinese people, aren't they? Because,
true.
You know, I mean, this is something that you can see distinctly different from...
Yeah, I do have men even coming in for waxing.
...races, but perhaps, you know, in India, you can see people, you know, want to keep hair at a certain, on a certain area of their face where they don't want it somewhere.
I do, I do have men coming for waxing even. Waxing chest hair. I do have, and because some of them are models.
They want it done by women itself, particularly?
No, not really. They actually want to look good. They're mainly models who come in and they want to get their, you know, chest hair waxed, or they want to get their goatee done. So we have our hairdresser who actually gets it done for them. Mm. Men are actually becoming more tougher to deal with.
But you have all kinds of specialists, don't you?
Sorry?
You have all kinds of specialists with you.
Yes, we have every single...
Hair, skin?
Yes. Hair, skin, body.
Okay.
And of course our fashion designer who will help them out with their clothes.
Okay.
Anything. Creative beauty.
What exactly do you in your spa? Is it just a feeling of wellness? Spa.
Spa. Spa, we actually give them, we have something called the ear candling, which you don't find it in India.
Okay.
They actually light up a candle in your ears.
Why?
And they actually do a detox for
My
you.
My God, that sounds so...
A candle in your ears.
Why?
And they actually do a detox for
My
you.
My God, that sounds so scary.
Take out all your dirt and whatever. And that is a common thing that we have in our spa, which lots of customers like it.
Okay.
We also have our foot reflexology, where you should lie down on this lazy boy chair, something that what you call over here, a lazy boy chair, and they go on with a foot reflex, which is also very good because your feet is connected to every single nerve in your body, every part of your body.
You do some acupuncture also?
We do cupping.
Okay.
We do cupping where they actually suck out the air. You know, sometimes, you know, people, it's so cold. Bangalore is so cold sometimes, okay? Example, a woman who gives birth, a lot of air goes into her body after giving birth. Mm. So there's this cupping and we actually suck out the air.
Mm.
And at the, you look like turtle at the end of the day. You look, you know, you have as if you've got patches of a ladybird. You look like a ladybird.
Okay.
You know, there'll be patches of round things all behind your back.
Does
I actually
it work?
Did it last month. I still have a patch here.
It works?
Yeah, it really works.
How?
It really works. Okay, after you will feel your body aching for that one night, and the next day when you wake up, you feel very light. And you go to the toilet properly.
Is it a very temporary feeling?
No, it's not a temporary feeling. You go to the toilet very regularly, you feel yourself detoxing.
Oh.
Yeah, and you will really sleep.
Is that tested once? In the sense, you know, people have done it before and you have somebody who has expertise in it.
Yes, even I did it. I did it last month. I still have a patch.
You try it on yourself first before you try it on your customers?
I try everything on myself first before I try it on my customers.
You don't want to get into trouble.
Yes, I don't wish to get into trouble. I think that's the last thing I want to, I know, I don't want to happen. Yeah. So, cupping, we do cupping. We do ear candling. Certain things that you don't get over here are what we do.
How is your beauty contest doing?
We did 2007, we did 2008, 2009 I was not able to do because I came up with my designer clothes, Daisy Morgan, and also Hyderabad came in, Hyderabad was born, so I was too busy with all those, I couldn't do my 2009 pageant. I'm looking forward to do 2010 in India.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm planning to bring Miss Singapore Indian Universal.
Okay.
Bring it in and make it Miss Indian Universal. But we still need to negotiate on the rights and stuff like that. So it's not confirmed yet. I do not know.
But you have the rights.
I do have the rights in Singapore. So in India, they do have a different kind of... Anyway, it involves a lot of things. It's not a simple thing. Like, in Singapore, I had so many people with me. I had a telecom company. I had Western Union. I had...
It's wiser for you to continue.
I even had the Indian High Com coming in for my event. But the thing is, it's not easy. I hope. I will do it. I will.
Okay, but you also plan to start something like an academy where you want to train more youngsters who want to get into this?
In our spa itself, we have a room for courses where we actually train people on makeup. My specialty is makeup. I do a lot of makeup for even movie stars, our local Singaporean movie stars and even India. And we have stars who come in from India sometimes for shoots and all. I actually do their makeup.
Okay.
So being professional in that, I actually conduct courses for colleges and all. We're actually doing this, you know, after their holidays, we actually go into colleges and give courses, 4 or 5 days, etiquette course or makeup course for the girls in India to keep themselves proper or get ready to meet their future.
But is it actually getting very scientific these days? Because, you know, I mean, it's not anymore an art, makeup particularly, that you have a lot of science in it, in the sense you need to actually, you know, adopt a lot of scientific methods to ensure that the skin also is treated well, that everything that you use, so how you do it, is done in a very systematic manner. Everything is tested and proven.
Definitely. You see, everything right now, it's done by man. It's everything man-made. We are not doing natural products anymore.
Okay.
The good thing, what I do is, in Singapore, I import. You see, the something is so weird, you know. In India, the people like the exported products. They want me to import products from my country, Singapore. They want me to import products and they only want to use the imported products.
Okay.
But in Singapore, the people want the products from India to be brought over. So what I do is whenever I travel every 2 weeks,
products Indian from products more than they trust.
Because Indian products are more of natural. We have the natural resources in India.
Okay.
But the people in India rather get the imported products from Singapore, which are all chemical.
Okay.
And the people in Singapore rather get the natural products which are from India, you see?
Now, how is it for a Singaporean citizen to come and live in Bangalore? Because, you know, you are from a country where you can't even, like you say, eat chewing gum or chew chewing gum.
Yeah.
You can't litter. You end up paying very, very huge fines. Everything is fine as long as you pay fines, you said.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly.
But do you actually find it very difficult here? Because, you know, when you walk about, you see a lot of litter, rubbish, dirt.
People spitting on the road.
Yeah.
You know, the first time when I came here, I had so much trouble. There was a point of time that I thought that I was not going to make it. I thought maybe, should I just go back and, you know, stay there? But it's all about your willpower, whether you want it or not.
Were you ready to live in this dirt and filth?
Today you can ask me to sleep in a train, I can sleep in a train. You ask me to sleep in a coach, I can do that.
But how is it when you go back? I'm sure that you carry some habits from here.
No, you see, living in a very rude country, our country is very rude, you know, order, law and order. We are very law and order people. From, as you said, we can't even, chewing gum is being banned, bubble gum is banned. Over here, bubble gum is like anyone and everyone can have
it. You can even put it under somebody's seat also.
My nieces and nephews came here for a holiday and they were like, bubble gum, oh, you know, every day they were chewing bubble gum nonstop. It's like a luxury for them. But in Singapore, you know, you don't get that.
Okay.
So what happens is, I do not adopt the practice in India. I adopt the practice in Singapore because I lived and I was born there, right? So, and I bring the rules over to India.
At least in your spa.
So all my girls follow the same practice.
Okay.
They don't litter. They clean the spa at least like 5 times in a day.
Oh.
They follow the proper etiquette. The right way of living.
But you also said Lee Kuan Yew is your role model.
Yes, that's right.
Right?
That's
a very tough role model you have.
Yeah.
Right? But why?
You see, Singapore is just an island. And it's an island where people from different countries came and there was nothing in that island, you know, undeveloped. And this man, this great man, developed the whole island to a country. Today we are the top 5 highest living country in the world.
Okay.
We are well taken care of, and it's all the instructions by him. He planned it, and he even
said he would also come out of his grave if there was any need, right?
Yeah, and he also planned what is in store for us for the next 50 years. Though he knows he's not going to be around in the next 50 years.
Yeah, but he always said that you'd be there even after him.
So,
after,
you know,
his time.
Exactly. So he didn't even think about himself or his own family. He put his whole family.
Selfless.
Yeah. His whole family was
for
the
him,
country.
Singapore was more than anything else.
Singapore was his family, you see.
Okay.
That's why our national anthem, we have got, when we sing our songs on Singapore National Day, you know, we have one people, one nation, one family.
Okay.
That's our theme. One people, one nation, one family. And on our national day, we sing in Tamil, in Malay, Muslim language, Chinese and English, all four languages.
You feel very emotional about your country.
Yeah, because you know, I'm so proud to know that our country is mixed up with all four races.
And we are not. Do you know that people try to make Bangalore Singapore?
I think Bangalore is
becoming. I don't think it's possible at all, right?
No, but it's becoming a cosmopolitan place, and I really like living in Bangalore.
Not about cleanliness at all, surely.
I think it's getting there compared to other states. I think Bangalore is really getting there
On its way to becoming Singapore.
I think they're doing a good job. The roads are really nice. I drove, like 3 days ago, I drove down alone from Chennai to Bangalore. The roads was really good compared to like 6 years ago. Mm. And I think the changes are there. It's just on progress.
Okay.
As long as the people stand hand in hand.
Mm. But you really look like a very energetic, enthusiastic woman. I'm sure that you'll do very well.
Yes, I've got lots of goals and I want to reach to it. I don't want... once you slack a little bit, that's it. You can't move. You know, it's like a car. Once the car loses its battery, you got to pump some more battery and then you got to keep moving. So it's like an energizer battery. Just recharge yourself and go again. And I would say God is my partner. My partner in every single business, every step I make. And even when it's a mistake, I learn. Every mistake I make, I'm a step closer to success.
Mm, I can only wish you all the best.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having come to this show.
Thank you.